You haven't downloaded BBC's Top Gear? This is in fact the introduction to Need for Speed for the Sega Saturn. And we've got loads of Saturn stuff coming up for you in Retrocore Volume 32. A lot more than what we usually cover. And even that's pretty healthy. So Saturn fans, you're going to be in for the treat. But kicking all off is Need for Speed. Now one thing you really got to forget about this game is the fact that it's got Need for Speed written on it, because it's nothing like the shit they bring out these days. This one is actually good and worth playing. Not much in the way of modes, to be honest. You've got basically got a straightforward racing against the computer mode. You've just got a two-player split screen mode as well. And you've also got a time trial, which is basically just a practice mode. Loads of cars to choose from though, most of them being European, mind you. We've got a good old Lambo. A big heavy piece of shit that steers like shit. But it's bloody fast. And speed's certainly something that this version of Need for Speed really does show. Okay, the car models look like shit. No arguing there, they do look bloody awful. But the actual course that you race along is actually quite lush. And certainly jam-packed full of side objects. And it does move at a nice pace. And look at the draw distance, can you see any pop-up? I think not. Struggling to turn there. Now one of the really nice things about Need for Speed is the ability to completely smash your car into another one. It is possible to get multi-car pile-ups if you time it right. I've had myself go over the jump, land on top of another car, have them overturn and have another load of cars slam into the back of me, and they give out for spin and toppling all over the road as well. Unfortunately, while making this video, I couldn't pull it off, but it does, it is in there. And when it happens, it's bloody magic. Oh, nice. Bit unrealistic, mind you. But then again, I've never driven a Lamborghini. Now, the game certainly got the visuals, well, apart from the car models, and certainly got the speed as well, but how does it handle? Well, I'm very happy to say it handles very well. The cars actually feel like they got some weight to them. You know, you can't just go turn around the corner hoping to make it, but it's just not going to happen. Just as if you were driving a real car. And of course you got the good old handbrake in there, so you can do some lovely power slides. But remember to ease off the accelerator or you find yourself spinning all over the place. Here you can see the little replay mode, which actually enables you to watch the entire race again. All sorts of tricks in there, such as freeze frame, stop motion, and of course reverse play. Now as I said at the beginning, don't be put off by the name Need for Speed, because this is absolutely nothing like the modern efforts. This is in fact a really good racer, and not just some cheap ass piece of crap with a load of licensed cars with the Need for Speed name stuck on it. In fact, as far as I know, this is the second Need for Speed game ever made, first one being on the 3DO, and that should have been Need Some Speed, not Need for Speed. If you're sat on it, you have to have a really good racer for your machine, one which is graphically impressive, this is certainly one to pick up. You won't be disappointed.
Riders! Welcome to the exciting comic world!
Game over.
more PC Engine shooting action with Final Soldier. Now with the PC Engine having loads of different shooters on it, you would have something a little bit special to make your shooter stand out, and Hudson have certainly done that with this game. It's a lovely little feature here which I really do like, is the ability to change all your different weapon power-ups before the game even starts. Very nice little option there. Now that Stage 1 Future Zone may look transparent to you, but it actually flickers like hell to give it a nice transparency effect. But due to the way that the DVD and its download version is produced, with the interlacing and the different frame rates, you get rid of all that flickering. So it does actually look transparent. Now see those two little things which are following me, one's just being exploded, they're actually smart bombs, as well as being options. Certainly come in handy for taking out some of these bosses. As you can clearly see, graphically, Final Soldier isn't anything too special, but does have this lovely effect here at the end of each level. Pretty nice, that is. Gameplay wise, there's nothing too special in there. Nothing that you haven't seen before in a 16-bit or an 8-bit shooter in this game's case. But the way it's executed is pretty nice, you know, the way the enemies come on and the enemy patterns of attack are actually quite impressive. For the time, that is. Nice bit of variation in there. And there are some tricky bullet patterns as well, which will certainly keep your reactions up. Here with the mid-level boss. Also, you may have seen at the beginning of this game when I was quickly shifting through the options that there's actually a 5-minute and 2-minute mode. Hudson seems to have stuck them in quite a few of their early PC Engine shooters as part of their Caravan series, which from what I remember is a competition which they used to hold every year in Japan. Basically, the aim of the 2-minute, 5-minute modes is just to get as much points as you can within the time limit. Certainly good for getting your practice in. So, Final Soldier, maybe not that tough, but certainly worth checking out.
Oh baby, come and play with me and my toys in Retro Course Mobile Phone Gaming.
It's that time again to get out your mobile phone and start downloading some games. Kicking it all off this month, we've got Stucco Battle Evolution. Coming to us from Genki, the company who makes all the console games. And just like the console versions of Stucco Battle, you can buy different cars. You can see here I've got an RX-8 and a Lancer Evolution 5. Nice. Loads of cars to choose from makers such as Nissan, Subaru, Mitsubishi, even shitty Daihatsu's in there. Well, they're not too shitty. As well, buying the car, you can buy all your parts for it. In fact, it's necessary to buy parts for your car, otherwise you're never going to beat the high-level opponents. Unfortunately, with Stucco Battle being based on the Tokyo Expressway system, The game actually comes in three parts, so you can actually download which section of the course you want. Each three sections are available on each separate download. But you don't have to really, you don't have to download all versions, to be honest, because just downloading one version will certainly keep you going long, keep you going for quite some time. So as you can hear, the sound on the game is actually pretty dire. You know, Genki really didn't put much effort into the music, that's for sure. This tune distorts like mad. Thankfully it plays really, really well. You know, first impressions I thought, my car's a bit slower than I thought, so are the console versions of the game. Once you've bought a few power-ups for your car and tuned your engine, goes like the clappers. Nice. At the moment you can see the screen's, well, it's just gone big again, but we had the screen a little bit smaller. That was the original screen size, which is in VGA. At the moment the screen's a bit larger, and this is the TV output mode, which, while it does give you a larger picture, it does make the graphics a little bit on the fuzzy side. So next game up, we got Star Wars Mobile Pod Racer. Again, here's the TV mode there, so we'll just switch it back into VGA for crisper graphics. And this game was made by Entertainment Brain. And it features a couple of goons from Star Wars, including that annoying little Sprog, Anakin Skywalker. Now, Entertainment Brain were actually the people who made the original Ridge Racer for the mobile phone. That's the one which is available on their Western phones, by the way. Not the one which is coming up after this. And the original Ridge Racer was okay, but it was a bit on the poor side when it came to frame rate. And this Star Wars Pod Racer Mobile is pretty much the same. They claim that it runs at 60 frames a second. I think what they should have said is that it peaks at 60 frames a second, but keeps dropping all the bloody time, especially when you go around corners. In the options screen, you do actually get a choice of 3D levels. You've got a high level 3D, mid level, and a low level. It doesn't matter what level you put it on, it's always the same speed. The only thing that changes is the amount of detail on the track. Unfortunately, controls are a bit on the shitty side as well. The sides are far too sensitive, especially on the outside view, it's impossible to control. Fair enough, it does look pretty good, you know, playing on your widescreen mobile phone, but that's about all you're going to get from it. It's a first impression of, wow, that looks nice. It soon wears off though. At the moment this game's only for Japanese mobile phones, because as far as I'm aware, there are no Western widescreen mobiles. But when they do become available, make sure you stay clear of this one. And here we go with Ridge Racer. Not accessing the network, you can bug it off there. Now this is a made by Namco themselves. Now we have featured this on MetroCore, but at that time I did use some software scaling to sort of fill up the screen, and it made the graphics look a bit on the fuzzy side. So here we go with the original VGA version, or VGA output. You got a quick look at the TV mode there. Also notice when you play the games in TV mode, they seem to lose a couple of frames as well. They do seem a little bit slower. Probably that's because the CPU is actually changing the display, I don't know. Again, currently this is only available for Japanese mobiles, but it will be available in the West. Since widescreen mobiles become available to buy. just keep checking out your Namco homepage for it. In fact, there's actually two versions available. There's this version and then there's the networked version, which you can actually play a versus race either via Bluetooth or over the network. I seriously don't recommend playing over the network because you're paying through the nose for the connection. Or at least in Japan you do. But over Bluetooth's pretty good. I'd be happy to know that this plays just like Ridge Racer. Mind you, it is a little bit easy, man, to be honest. And here we go with the highlight game of this month's mobile gaming. Yep, it's everyone's favourite witch. This is Cotton in Fantastic Night Dreams. Originally ported from the arcade, this mobile phone version actually improves on the arcade in every way. Well, maybe the audio doesn't, but still not too bad. So this mobile phone version is actually full of transparencies and actually uses real rotation effects, whereas the arcade actually animated everything. As far as I remember, it didn't have transparencies either. Now I know you probably can't see this on the download version of RetroCore, well, DVD version should be able to, but the amount of detail in the graphics on this game are amazing, especially when you see it running on your mobile phone screen. You know, it's quite impressive what they can do nowadays. Now I know a lot of people say, well, N-Gage has got real 3D stuff on and all that, but the thing is, N-Gage is made for gaming, isn't it? It's basically just a bloody console with a phone bolted on. Or the phone with a shitty console bolted on. Whereas this game's made for mobile phones which aren't games machines, it's actual phones, which just happens to run Java applications. Actually, I love these little guys that come on there when you continue. Now, when you compare this to the really poor efforts the 18 gave us, with Battle Garage and Soku Gunentai, it makes you wonder how they can get away with releasing such piss poor conversions on mobile phones and you know, charging you for them. Now, success, every game I've got from my mobile phone from success has been top quality. Got the Easy Racer, which certainly puts a lot of PlayStation and Sega Saturn few system races to shame, graphically and playability wise. They also did a Saivaria R, which again is very, very impressive. You know, certainly wouldn't go out of place on the Sega Saturn. And now we've got a Cotton. Again, a wonderful game. Looks great, sounds good, and plays like a dream. Now just watch out for the hands coming up in the background when the screen goes red, it looks really nice. I also like this bit here when you kill the witch woman. A heart comes out, there you go, and it explodes. And all the blood shoots up into the air and then starts raining blood. Really nice stuff. Now this bit's a bit different than the original arcade version. The music should actually change here. And she should say ping or whatever she says when she collects the little teacups. So that was Cotton and Magical Night Dreams. This month's recommended game for your mobile phone. Check out the Success homepage. And who said the Sega Saturn couldn't do clean FMV? This is Burning Rangers. By Sonic Team, actually, this is the second Sonic Team game we're featuring this month, isn't it? And it's actually one of the showpieces of the Sega Saturn, but unfortunately Sonic Team tried to cram so much stuff into it that it actually buggers up your Sega Saturn. Well, it doesn't actually bugger up your Sega Saturn, but you can see your Sega Saturn's working its ass off to perform what the Sonic Team were asking it to do. So straight from the introduction to the very snazzy option selection screen, you know you're in for something special. エネルギーロが非常に危険な状態に突入。なお避難が確認されていない研究所員が若干いるもよう。各地非常用ボートから侵入。速やかに行動を開始して。ショートビッグは施設の延焼を食い止めつつ、要救助者の救助を。了解。Now that woman's voice you can hear rabbiting on the background is actually telling you where to go in the game, and she's also telling you about your teammates, or I suppose you call your co-workers or whatever. You know, the rescuers, and what they're up to and whereabouts they are. And throughout the game she'll be telling you which direction to go into, which doors to check out and so on. Unfortunately it's all in Japanese, but you'd be happy to know in the English version, it is in English. But it actually is quite a nice touch, because it really does give you the feeling that you're on some sort of mission, having a running commentary in the background telling you what to do. And it's actually varied enough to make you not realise that it's actually recording. The timing on it is actually quite accurate. You'll be going past the door and next thing you know you'll hear the woman shout out, you know, check out the door. That's just told me there, watch out for the bombs and make your way up to the top door. Which I did. The whole aim of Burning Rangers is quite simple, really. Basically, find as many people as possible to rescue. Find yourself the way out through all the mazes. And put out the fires. And of course, stop yourself getting blown up by bombs. Just like that. The thing that makes Burning Rage so special is the atmosphere in the game. As I've already mentioned, the running commentary, or the guides, really does add a lot to it. But also, the communication between the different characters as you're playing is also a nice touch. And the voice actor is certainly top notch. Control wise, the controls are actually quite fluid. Whoa! Blown away by a backdraft there. Pretty nice as well. As I was saying there, characters go where you put them. So there's no trouble there. Nice responsive controls all around. Graphically, some of the graphics, as you can certainly see, are very, very impressive. In fact, it certainly put a lot of PlayStation games to shame. Unfortunately, Sonic Team have tried to push the Sega Saturn that much that you do get an awful lot of polygon flickering. I know you could be walking right past a wall and, you know, it might be like a couple of centimetres in front of you and it'd be flickering on and off, like, flickering on and off, I should say. Like, boogery, you know, because they're pushing the Sega Saturn that hard to display so many transparencies and special effects that Saturn's having a bloody heart attack. But when you're in areas that are flickering like hell, it certainly does look impressive, especially with all that transparency in there. Or should I be saying translucent colours? It's actually transparency, you can't see it, can you, because it's transparent? Now, Burning Rage also features this little feature here, where you get mails from the people who you rescued, which is quite nice. Loads of people to rescue as well, so once you're pleased to complete the game with the female character or the male character, you can play it with the alternative character, and also the secret characters you can play the game as well. These underwater sections look beautiful. Makes you wonder why Tomb Raider looks so shit, doesn't it? As you can see there, the camera's panning through the walls. Bit of a problem. But overall, Burning Rage is a very nice game. It's only got 4 levels, but the levels are quite long. And, you know, it should take you quite some time to get through them. And certainly, you got to play them more than once as well to rescue other people. So overall, I'd say Burning Rage will last you quite some time. Certainly not one you're going to finish at the weekend. Completely. Do get the game, make sure you get the Japanese version for the lovely free CD soundtrack.
ドラキュラ早く買わなくちゃ。 Konami.
TV! Ichigo da kanida! Bima da! Makaru da TV! Domo to wo torimo to se! Uraaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaaa
ミリーコンピューター登場。カセットを挿入するとカラー52色の鮮やかな画像、コンピューターを相手に麻雀、五目並べ、そしてポパイ、ドンキーコング、2人で楽しめるマリオブラザーズなど10種類、ポーズボタンと切り替えスイッチで簡単にテレビ番組に変わるテレビ共存タイプ、家族揃ってファミリーコンピューター。
Who would have thought that when the PC Engine came out, you'd be seeing Neo Geo conversions on it? And not just some half-assed Neo Geo conversions either. Bloody good Neo Geo conversions. In fact, so good, you'd think they were the Neo Geo game. At first glance, anyway. This is Garan Densetsu Special. Better known as Fatal Fury Special. And I'm very happy to say that this PC Engine version is in fact a lot better than the Super Famicom version, which I highly praise. Even though the controls are a little bit off, to be honest. But certainly impressive Harry for the Super Famicom. And this Neo Geo, this PC Engine version comes to us on the PC Engine Arcade CD-ROMs. It's basically just a normal CD-ROM. But of course you need the arcade cards, which gives the PC Engine a lot more memory. A bit like the Sega Saturn's 4 MB RAM card, to be honest. And as you can see, the results are spectacular. This is very impressive stuff. Now if we go to compare this to another CD version, well, you'd have to compare it to the Mega CD version, wouldn't you? And I'm afraid I'm going to have to say that this PC Engine version is a lot better than the Mega CD version in all areas. Well, maybe except the loading times. Even those aren't that bad. Okay. As you may notice from the introduction, the conversion was actually done by Hudson Soft. Who not only did this PC Engine version of Garand and Sensu Special, but also did their own fighting game based on their Kabuki guy. Who I actually hate. And they also did World Heroes Perfect as well, which is very impressive. And I believe they may have also done Art of Fighting, but I haven't actually seen that one, so I couldn't say whether that's true or not. Oh, sorry for the lack of moves there, but as you can tell, I'm a bit shit with Kim. Actually, I keep trying to get special out, but it's not that easy, to be honest. In fact, that's the only thing that holds the game back from being actually spectacular is a PC Engine controller. Not that it's a bad controller or anything, but getting out some of the SNK special moves on the PC Engine controller is not an easy task. Anyone who's tried playing this on the Super Famicom will certainly know what I mean. Mega Drive 6 button controller is a lot easier to call the moves out on. But you know, that's only a minor grumble. I suppose once you get accustomed to the pads, you'll probably find yourself calling that moves all the time. Anyway, needless to say that Battle Fury Special on the PC Engine Arcade CD-ROM is very impressive. Surprisingly, not that expensive either. Just, so if you own yourself a PC Engine CD-ROM, PC Engine Duo RX or whatever, get yourself this game, but don't forget to get the arcade card along with it, otherwise you'll be playing nothing. What a classic line. And as you know, all know, it's by Bruce Campbell, the good old man from Evil Dead. Doesn't sound like him, mind you, does it? Or at least it doesn't sound like him when he's in Evil Dead. But here's him. This is Duke Nukem 3D for the Sega Saturn. One Sega Saturn game that had Saturn owners pulling down the pants, shoving the dick in PlayStation owners' faces and saying, suck this, you bastard. Yep. One game that showed the Saturn could do pretty good 3D, if given to the right people. The Bottom Meat Software made this conversion, the people who brought it Exhumed, the Power Slave as it was called in the US, and also believed the Sega Saturn version of Quake, which was also very impressive. As you can clearly see, the Sega Saturn version of Duke Nukem 3D does move at quite a nice pace, and the screen size is fairly respectable as well. In fact, it's full screen. Oops, fell out of the window. I'm sure you should say hubba hubba there or something like that. Did last time I played it anyway. What was that when you see some dancing in the bar? Can't remember now. Unfortunately, Duke Nukem 3D was never released in Japan, only released in Europe, and actually, no, come to think of it, it was released in the US as well. So unfortunately, I won't be able to get a Japanese version of the game, but that doesn't matter because I've got this European one. First person shooters are your thing, and you got yourself a Sega Saturn and you thought all you had to play on it was The Bottom Is Exhumed, think again. Track down a copy of Duke Nukem now and get it. And once you've got this, make sure you get yourself Quake as well, and probably leave Hexen though. Next one, I'll two-player link-up modes. Since there's been a lot of talk about Knights coming out on the Wii, I thought, wouldn't it be nice to have Knights on the Sega Saturn? And because it's such a great game, it actually made Game of the Month. Now, a lot of people criticise Knights, and I think that's because they haven't actually sat down and played it properly. Because there's no one who can honestly say Knights is a bad game. Of course, you can say that you can't actually get into Knights, and that's why you don't like it that much, but you can't turn around and say it's a bad game, because it certainly is not. Now, I'll admit, when I first played Knights all those years ago when it first came out, I was thinking, oh, what's so fucking good about this? You know, you just sort of fly around from A to B. Alright, it looks pretty. Especially this level where you fly across the floor, when you fly across the floor and it sort of distorts and bends because it's made of rubber. But anyway, as I was saying, you just seem to fly from point A to B, and that was it, I thought. And that's because I wasn't getting into the game. The whole thing about Knights is to use your areas. You know, you can find yourself making some amazing maneuvers while playing the game. You can find yourself getting some really good score attacks as well, just like a shooter. fact, that's one of the main points of the game, to get your score up as fast as high as you can using the abilities of knights. And the game moves at such a lovely fluid pace that you'd be hard-pressed to think that it was a mid-generation Sega Saturn title. And very little, if any, slowdown whatsoever. Of course, some areas do push the Sega Saturn a little bit, so you do get a little bit of spray flicker here and there. But overall, it's pretty solid. Also, Knights was the first game to feature the A-Life system, which became more popular in the likes of Sonic Adventure on the Dreamcast. It all originated here in Knights. Now, the ultimate goal of Knights is to get yourself all A rankings, and to do that isn't exactly easy, so you are going to have to put a lot of practice in. Not that you'd mind doing it, because you'd have such a great time in the process of practicing. See the clock there is actually in real time, so you may notice what time I made this video. Another lovely feature about Knights is the music. It's all generated on the fly, so you know, you could be playing the game, you know, doing really well, and you got a lovely upbeat tempo. Next thing you know, you're doing really bad, and the music's actually completely changed. Is here when on foot. Actually, it's quite interesting exploring the areas on foot. But you gotta watch out though, because if the dreaded time clock gets you, it's game over. Oh, here it comes now. Come on, run yourself, cow. Ow. So if you've got a Sega Saturn and you've never experienced Knights, do yourself a favour and get it. Make sure you get the analog pad to go along with it though. Shows a hell of a lot better with the analog. It's Hyper Duel coming to us from Technosoft, the masters of the classic shooters. Now, being a Technosoft game, you'd expect it to have some sort of resemblance to Thunder Force, and Hyper Duel certainly does. There are two modes available. We've got Arcade mode, which is basically the same as the original arcade, and Sega Saturn mode, which features better colour and a whole new CD stream soundtrack. Now, as I mentioned, this game does feature quite a lot of resemblances to the Thunder Force series, as you'll see straight away with a couple of these enemies which are coming on. And also, you notice the speech is quite similar as well for the powered ups. Now, like a lot of the classic shooters from the past, Hyper Duel doesn't feature any sort of special score attack. I'm not doing any of it either. It's basically a plain old classic horizontal scroll and shoot 'em up, where your points are earned by blasting as many things as possible in no particular fancy order, thank very much treasure. The ship's got, well, you can call it a ship because it turns into a robot as well. Okay, your craft has two modes, the ship mode and the robot mode. Ship mode, as you'd expect, can only fire straight forward, but it's also got the ability to get a couple of missiles which home in. I can also let off with a bit of special, for lack of a better word, which sets off a load of laser spinning around your ship, which also takes out enemies. Then you have the mech mode, or the robot mode, in which you can shoot a horizontally in front of you or diagonally up and down. And you can move this shot completely freely, or you can lock into place by holding down one of the buttons. Actually comes quite in handy for killing some of the bosses, to be honest. What do you think I get to the bosses, judging by the way I'm playing this at the moment? Keep really dying. I suppose that's a good point, because at least you know the Hyper Duel's not some walk in the park that you finish in one sitting. Like a few PC engine shooters I've been playing these days. Oh, I shouldn't say that really, should I? Because there's a pretty lot of good PC engine shooters as well. So it's Hyper Duel there for the Sega Saturn. A worthy purchase, but it will cost you a lot of money.
無駄にするなって言ってんのよ。
葉月レオさんですよね。私周英さんのお手伝いをさせてもらってます。クン・ファンメイです。
私たちの両親を殺された。兄は今のあなたのように仇を追って、そして邪道に落ちた。あなたは邪道に落ちてはいけない。
ファミコンアドベンチャーゲーム水晶のドラゴン。
信じたい、仲間を信じたい、自分を信じたい。
敵を倒し未来を開け、銃と剣で戦うアクションシューティング、任天堂64、罪と罰、星の継承者。
ついにあの男の物語が、ドラマチックアクションゲームとして復活。やめて、やめて、北斗の剣世紀末救世主伝説。
人はどれだけ強くなればいいのだろう。聖剣伝説プロローグキャンペーン実施中。
セガサターン。
巨大研究機関デザイア、禁断の扉が開かれ、世界は地獄に変貌する。ゲーム史上最高画質を誇る超ビレームービールシッドモーションに感情をリアルに表現する AVSS を加え、あのギブバーストエラーの制作スタッフが再び結集。マルチサイトアドベンチャーゲームデザイア、店頭にて予約受付中。
ラジオ
one of the very first games to ever start being produced for the Sega Dreamcast, this is D2, originally planned for the ill-fated Panasonic M2. Of course, this Dreamcast version is completely revamped from the original concept that was going to appear on the Panasonic. But it's also true that this was one of the very first, if not the first, Sega Dreamcast game to stop production. And when you think about how old it is, you know, it was in production in, you know, early 1998. It looks amazing compared to some of the other shite that came out. In fact, I've actually got a beta version of this, and everything does look a lot more, I'd say, triangular, especially the characters. Anyway, I'll give you a bit of a background on the story, just in case you don't know. The woman on the bed, that's Lara. And she was on her way to Canada, and as she was flying over the Rocky Mountains, some voodoo witch doctor decided to do a curse and blow up the plane. So the plane nosedives into the ground. She wakes up, finds herself in this hut with Kimberly. And then this guy walks into the cabin and turns into a monster. Certainly got the makings to be a horror movie. Of course, being Japanese, you gotta have tentacles in there. And when you got tentacles, you got rape. Is it with the Japanese and their tentacle rapes? God knows. Anyway, needless to say that this guy gets taken out by Parker, who Kimberly's in love with. I see him a bit later on, actually. So once that's all dealt with, Laura goes out in search of finding out what's going on. She comes across the plane which crashed, and inside she got the stewardess. Or flight attendant as the now known. Unfortunately, she's being possessed as well. Now Kenji Endo has certainly got some warped minds when it comes to making games. Some of the stuff in D2 has got to be some of the most warped and imaginative, well, creatures and ideas I've ever seen in a video game. In fact, you couldn't actually just call this a video game, it's a movie, to be honest. Now, the whole atmosphere which Kenji produces with this game is amazing. You know, from the soundtrack to the storyline to the way the camera moves, the man's got everything down to a T. Like, some of the camera work in this game can easily be described as movie quality. In fact, it puts Shenmue to shame, to be honest. Now, I've never actually played the English language version of this game, so God knows what the voice acting is like. Could be shit like pretty much everything else, but then again, it could be good. But in this Japanese version, as you can clearly hear, the voice acting's spot on. It's really good stuff. So this crazy fat old lady coming down the stairs here says that Laura and the girl killed her son. Not only did they kill them, but they also ate him. Or ate him. She's asking if they had fun and what sort of flavor the sun was. Like I said, Kenji Endo's warped. Movement when you're in the house is all on the rails, unfortunately. But then again, all of Kenji Endo's games seem to be like that. There's the original D, and there's also Enemy Zero for the Sega Saturn. Both of them are on rails. Mind you, even though it's on rails, you do get some sort of freedom of movement. There are quite a few paths to take. But at some points it can be a little bit frustrating because you actually want to see something but it won't allow you to. So, you know, sometimes it can be a bit of a pain in the ass, to be honest. In fact, that's got to be the game's major down point. But then again, it's not really that bad, that's just the style of the game. Gameplay in these sections is your typical search for clues, solve a few puzzles, and so on. Here we go, there's Parker, he's actually being turned into a mutant as well. Now, this is actually quite a touching scene, this bit. She tells Parker that she loves him, and we'll see what happens next. It's actually better acting than most Japanese TV dramas I see. So throughout the game you can take photographs of things you see around the area. Here's a couple of photographs of bloody weird shit things I saw. God knows what they are. But you do find some weird shit in this game. There you go, it's a gay Pokemon. So anyway, while Lord is outside she can run around searching for items and so on. But while she's out there in the cold, lonely, snowy mountains of Canada, she's gotta watch out because it's full of bloody monsters! So it's very important to keep yourself well stocked up on ammo. As you can see, we've got loads of weapons to choose from, including one of my favourites, the hand grenade. And in typical RPG fashion, every time you kill a monster, you get your stats boosted. Nice shotgun there. If you're playing the game, you can always rely on the shotgun. So as you can probably imagine, walking all over the mountains is going to be quite tiresome. Because the areas are vast, and I mean vast, much bigger than Shenmue to be honest. So luckily, Laura can hop on a snowmobile. Unfortunately, she keeps falling off the bloody thing, she's that much of a crap driver. There you go. So that's D2 from Warp. Not only a game, but an interactive movie. Coming to us from the Warp Mind of Kenji Endo. If you've never played it, I certainly recommend you do. Time for RetroCore to take another look at a bit of Japanese hardware. Today we've got the PC Engine Duo. Now the PC Engine coming to us from NEC in partnership with Hudson. Came in many forms. Originally there was the white PC Engine, then there was the PC Engine Core Graphics, which was a grey colour like this one, and then there was a whole host of add-ons as well. Now the Duo was the first machine to feature both the CD-ROM and the Hue card in one machine. There's also a Duo R and a Duo RX. Of course, the original Duo is the best, because it's the only one that features a headphone socket with a volume control. The Duo R and the Duo RX may look better cosmetically, but basically they are the same machine. Minus the headphone socket and the volume control. Unfortunately, the PC Engine only has a composite output, no RGB, unless you do a mod, which is bloody stupid. But it's not all bad news, because the PC Engine was home to some amazing original games as well as some very good arcade conversions. You can see there you've got Space Harrier, you've got Atomic Robo Kid, and even Vigilante. And in fact, a lot of the arcade conversions were a lot better than those featured on other machines. Except for Ninja Warriors there, that was a lot of shit. Now, as I said, as well as featuring games on a card form, known as Hue cards, there's also CD games for the machine. Now, the CD games come in three different forms. There's the original CD-ROM, the Super CD-ROM, and the Arcade CD-ROM. Now, if you've got a Duo, all you need is the one card to make them all work. Unfortunately, if you don't have a Duo and you've got a PC Engine with an extra CD-ROM system stuck onto it, you're going to have to buy yourself some certain cards to make all these games work. Unfortunately with a Duo, or fortunately with a Duo I should say, all you need is the Arcade Duo card that'll make everything run. Basically it's just in the memory expansion, to be honest. So the PC Engine is one hell of a good machine, but how does it compare to the Sega Mega Drive? Well, let's take a look at a few games which released on both systems. Of course, this is only a small selection. There are loads of games released on the Mega Drive and the PC Engine. We'll start off with Zero Wing. We've got Golden Axe, both of their PC Engine versions of CD. We've got Ballast 3 and Aero Blasters. So, which versions are better?
こちら地球連邦本部連合艦隊応答願います
こちら艦隊司令ワイルダー大佐
So let's not forget that the PC Engine version of Zero Wing is on CD-ROM, which of course gives you all these lovely cutscenes with speech in them.
アビゴールの奇襲攻撃を受けた全員戦闘態勢に入れキングゼロワン
As you can see, it's completely different from the original Mega Drive introduction.
Keiki, all green! Overboost to Tenka! Shiroku, Saidai! Scramble Hashin, OK!
Hachimara Shousa, これより我が艦の指揮を離れ、地球連邦本部からの指令を仰げ。生きていたら地球で会おう。
はい!
And of course, being on CD, you get a lovely CD soundtrack.Graphically, it does look pretty good. In fact, I didn't even know this was on the PC and the CD-ROM until I bought it. Have you even heard of it? Yeah, overall, it's a fairly decent looking arcade conversion. And plays pretty well as well.A little bit of sprite flicker in there, mind you. Okay, so let's take a look at the Mega Drive version of Zero Wing. Of course, Mega Drive version being on cartridge, so it's not going to feature a CD soundtrack like this one, but going to feature an introduction.Of course it does, and we all know the famous Mega Drive introduction. The one that spawned all your base belonged to us. Unfortunately, this is the Japanese version, so you're not going to get to see that. Now, I'm not being a fanboy or anything here, but this introduction does have a lot more feeling to it. But the PC Engine introduction is, you know, fine and dandy, it's pretty decent. But, you know, It just seems to be bolted on there. It doesn't have any healing in there. It's just there. Well, this Mega Drive introduction sort of captures the feel of the game. I think the music helps it quite a lot, to be honest. This introduction doesn't have any music. So into the game we go. Straight away you can see that the Mega Drive and the PC Engine versions do look very similar. The Mega Drive version, when you send out your beam to capture enemies, the beam is actually quite a lot bigger, quite a lot longer I should say. It makes catching enemies a lot easier. And it sounds pretty decent as well for cartridge. Must point out though that the Mega Drive version does seem to be a lot harder than the PC Engine version. And this is on the easiest level setting as well. PC Engine didn't even have a level setting. So that was Zero Wing. Both pretty nifty versions. Now let's have a look at Ballast 3. First game originally came out on the PC Engine, which is this one you're seeing now, again CD. Some of the CD music in this game is actually pretty good. It's this tune, but some of them are actually inferior to the cartridge versions. Don't adjust them up too much, you see. You'll also notice that in the PC Engine version, the background of the city is actually on fire for some unknown reason. Also a cameo Godzilla if you look closely. And of course, being CD, it's got all the speech. Whereas the Mega Drive version is just a load of text. Now, fortunately, this PC Engine version does play actually a little bit on the stiff side. But to its plus side, it does feature quite a lot of cinema scenes, an awful lot more than the Mega Drive cartridge version does. So let's take a look at the Mega Drive version. Coming to us from the exact same people, telling it. As you can see straight away that the graphic detail is actually a little bit higher, especially on that building. The city background's completely different as well. Mega Drive version does actually feature less levels than the PC and CD-ROM version as well, but to be honest, the levels which are missing all of the crap anyway, so I think Telena decided to remove them on purpose. The computer AI seems to be a lot better as well in this Mega Drive version, and as you can see, graphically it is a lot better. Well, not a lot better, but it is a little better. It also seems to play a lot quicker as well. So Telnet have tightened up the controls for this Mega Drive release. But unfortunately, as I did say, it's missing a few levels and it does miss an awful lot in the cinemas as well. And of course, no speech. Still quite nice for the cartridge, I guess. Well, possibly I'd have to go with the PC Engine version on this one. But it's a close call. And here we go with Golden Axe. Surprisingly, the PC Engine CD version is coming to us from Telenet. Seems to do a lot of PC Engine stuff, didn't they? And the instructions are right. Got a nice character select screen. And keeping with CD tradition, it's even got an introduction as well. Actually, the introduction has gone for quite some time and explained the entire reason for the characters to be involved in the battle against Death Adder. Oh, but just look at that! That's fucking shit! Not only are the characters little weedy farting things, but the sound effects are pathetic, the background graphics are pathetic, and it slows down, believe it or not, and it even bloody loads in. That's right. You must have screen pause every now and then before the character suddenly pops on. Just shit in every possible way. In fact, I'm sure it's a conversion of the Master System game, not the bloody arcade or the Mega Drive. Awful, PC Engine's own. Definitely capable of doing a lot better than this crap. On the plus side, going for it, it's the CD soundtrack, but then again, if you play the Mega CD remake of the Mega Drive version with the CD soundtrack, you've got no reason to play that PC Engine version if you go with the Mega Drive one. Clearly, you can see straight away it's a higher quality game from the introduction screen. Arcade style character select. Characters are a little bit small to be honest, but compared to the PC Engine version, they actually look arcade quality. Mind you, they're not though. But what makes it even more sad that the PC Engine one is so bad is the fact that this is one of the early Mega Drive titles. Ah, tell them I should have got their ass kicked for that PC Engine monstrosity. It's really clear that the Mega Drive version of Golden Axe shits on the PC Engine CD version from a great height. No competition. And finally, let's compare the two versions of Aero Blasters, or Airbus as it was known in the arcade. This is the PC Engine version. Got a nice little introduction here which the Mega Drive version doesn't have. Two player mode as well. Yeah, it looks fairly decent, looks pretty close to the arcade original. And the audio's not too bad. Certainly heard better though on a Hue card. There's one weird thing actually, that this PC Engine version does feature some different soundtracks and some stages compared to the Mega Drive version. Which the Mega Drive version actually came from Kemco, the original producer of the arcade. So there you go, that's the PC Engine version. Overall, pretty impressive. And there's the Mega Drive version. Again, features 1-2 players. Now one thing you will notice that on this Mega Drive version, the sort of smart bomb power bar at the top of the screen is always present, whereas on the PC Engine version it disappeared during boss battles, which made it a pain in the ass trying to figure out when your bar was charged back up, but you couldn't see it. No idea what the reason for that was. Perfectly, this does look a lot more beefy than the PC Engine version. Certainly a lot closer to the arcade original. I've got to love the soundtrack as well. Big, big, beefy synth drums. So I think, as far as Airbus is concerned, I'd go with the Mega Drive version. Mind you, both versions are very good. So let's check out some of the other games on the PC Engine from my collection. Of course, the PC Engine is home to many great games. So let's check them out. So we'll start off with the Hue Card games. This is Download. There's also a sequel to this, Download 2, obviously, for the CD-ROM. Well, personally, I prefer this original version. Quite a nice cyberpunk-style shooter. Come to us from NEC themselves. Of course, the PC Engine being home to millions of shooters, so any new shooter that comes out on it did have quite a task to be noticed. Here's another one. This comes from Naxat. This is Paranoia. A very weird shooter in every way. Not only is the ship they control completely and utterly nuts. God knows what it is, but the actual stages are mad as well. As if you're playing as somebody's nightmare. It may look like you're on a sunny beach at the moment, but the next thing you know, it's a rip in space. And the game gets even more weird the more you go on as well. It's one of my favourites on the PC Engine. This is Ninja Spirits. An amazing conversion from the arcade original. Even includes the PC Engine mode where you can get hit 3 times before you die. Of course, the PC Engine home to millions of well-known games such as Castlevania and so on, but you can see them on YouTube anytime, couldn't you? Here's another one, maybe not exactly a great game, not a bad game either, but definitely graphically impressive for the PC Engine Hue card. This is Twinbee. Even features all the introductions from the arcade Sega Saturn version. And back in the late 80s, there was only one way you could play Space Harrier affordably, and this was it, on the PC Engine. May not be arcade perfect, but certainly was the best around then. Okay, so let's check out some of the CD titles. Of course, CD titles do have loads of intros and loads of speech as well on CD soundtrack. This is Psychic Storm, coming to us from Telnet. Now this game is actually quite easy. I finished on my first go, believe it or not. But one thing that does make it interesting is the fighter which you control. It's actually a biofighter. It can turn form into just things as a butterfly. That's what I think it is. But quite an interesting weapon system. The game isn't that expensive, to be honest. One of the many arcade conversions to the PC Engine CD, this is World Heroes 2, actually converted by Hudson Soft. Oh, what a fantastic job they've done! Just look at that! Gee, looks like the Neo Geo. Hard to believe it's running on a PC Engine. And NCS Misaya, one of my favourite companies, also brought out an awful lot of games for the PC Engine. This is one of their shooters, Eldis. More NCS Messiah action here. Three games in this series. This is Shibibi Man. Of course, this being the third one, it's on CD and it's got all the introductions as you'd expect. And the actual gameplay levels are graphically a lot better than the second game and a million times better than the first game, which are both on Hue cards. Basically, it's a comedy platform slash 'em up. And here's one which you never did get a chance to play in the arcade. This is Horror Story. Original arcade by Toplan. And this PC Engine CD-ROM version is actually quite similar to the original. And as far as I know, it's the only home console version ever made. And I'm back with NCS Misaya again. There are three of my games on the PC Engine. This is probably the best one. It's a 2D beat-em-up with loads of full-screen cutscenes. Of course, they're not as good as the Mega CD version cut screens. But again, the Mega CD version is also a crappy game. To be honest, with the Mega CD could they actually pull off a lot better stuff than the PC Engine CD. You have to look at Urusa Yatsura on the Mega CD to see that, and their Silphid. But unfortunately, you never did get the talents which the PC Engine CD had, which makes it the better machine overall. Pretty good games on it. Now on this Remy game, you can actually do specials, but I'm crap at it.